chair of Somerset Town Neighbourhood Forum, and I'm going to talk about Central Somerset Town CIP. Central Somerset Town CIP is a development to rebuild Edith Neville's primary school, what's a permanent nursery, it's an Irish primary school, new building, Block 10 Play Centre, replacement community of Hopkins Lane, and 136 new homes, 44 of which will be socially rented, 92 of which will be private. Of the 44 socially rented homes, 20 will be afforded by the scheme and 24 will be paid through from the Affordable Housing Fund, which is separate fund. So this is Camden Council paying for homes on its own now. All the buildings except for the school will be on designated open space, either private or public open space. And so you've got the loss of more than five tennis courts worth of open space in an area with the highest density of children in Camden and very few private gardens. Planning application was submitted in December 2015. It was approved in October 2016 and work is now started at the newly named school. It's a 7-year project. So following Sian's sort of look at the way that the scheme developed, I wanted to go back to the 2013 scheme, which was also approved by the Cabinet in December 2013. It was replacing the same community buildings and it was building 24 social rented homes through the construction and sale of 68 private homes. So at that point, we were getting more social rented homes for fewer private homes to give the same result. Cost of the scheme. We know community buildings, landscape, and school in the 2013 scheme was projected to cost £15 million. Because they told us. And they didn't tell us how much the actual scheme that they're going ahead with is going to cost, but the London Mayor's Stage 2 planning report revealed that it's going to cost £27 million. So we've got costs going up by 80% in 2 years. So you might wonder why did the costs rise so much? It's very difficult to tell because we don't have an open book policy. We can't look at the viability assessment. So we've got no real way of challenging the figures. But the school design that they came up with at the end, they decided rather than doing a one form entry primary school, they're going to do a school which could be expanded to two form entries. So it's only going to have one class year at a time, but it's going to have all the kitchen space, hall space, drama studios for a two form entry primary school, so they can easily expand it in the future. And also, they decided to fund the scheme by building the highest residential tower in Camden, and towers are really expensive to build. They take a long time. You can't put people in the ground floors while you're building floors above them. They cost more and they're less efficient. So they're also, I sort of thought, drilled down on a couple of other reasons why maybe costs we've got out of hand. They're building a children's centre, which they actually cut in 2015 before they put in the planning. So the school is actually big enough to have a children's centre as well. There's actually no guaranteed funding for any kind of children's centre services in that building. And as we know, Camden recently changed the offer that they're giving to all 2 and 3 year olds in Camden. So we now have them building a children's centre, a 2 year old's play centre, and a 3 year old nursery with very dubious funding. Why pay over the odds for social housing? Yeah, I asked the question if the additional floor space was going to be 2,369 square metres and it's costing £10.3 million. The construction costs are over £4,000 a square metre, and that's actually double what it should be in London at the moment, which is one of the highest rates in the world. So I was wondering why that was, and I was told by the planning officer it's not about land, which Camden are providing the money for from the Affordable Housing Fund. So we're having to compensate the developer for building that housing. He said that it makes sense. It doesn't make any sense to me.
Oh, God.
Driven by assetization.
It's what?
Maximizing assets.
Maximizing your assets.
Makes sense.
They have a duty to make money. So, the Nativist Forum position, we value green spaces. We wanted to actually designate the green spaces that all this is being built on, local green spaces. We want to see air quality in some town improve. It's very poor at the moment. We've got this nightmare scenario of HS2, Crossrail 2, Maria Galas, British Library, all these developments are happening at the same time, and we would like cumulative impact of those developments to be looked at. We support the rebuilding of even level schools. The school has never been satisfactory, and we know it needs to be done, but we believe there's a cheaper, better, and more durable solution summer time. So we put in an alternative plan, which was back of the envelope kind of thing, but it was, they looked at it and they said it could generate sufficient value to build a new school and complete the naming and infrastructure works associated with the new private housing and school. And then they decided that they were going to go ahead with their schema after all. It's actually really frustrating that you can't look at the figures. They wouldn't even show us the figures on their own plan, but they're not prepared to. It seems to me that the council aren't prepared to look at alternatives. One of the main reasons that they couldn't build over the school, they said, was to expand it in future decades. And we asked why, and they said the population in Southampton is going to increase by 47.4% by 2028. So we wondered what they were going to put in the water.
Yeah.
And they then revealed that they now consider Southampton to include the Argent development, the King's Cross development. So the reason why we have to expand our school is because of all that new housing that's going on in the King's Cross. And in fact, in King's Cross, they have got their own 2 formatory primary school, which is supposed to be sufficient for the needs of the population of moving in. So I think it's all smoke and mirrors, to be honest. Time for housing to close. I mean, this is hugely controversial to us because they're not mixing 10 of the blocks they're proposing. They're having private housing and then they're having social housing. And one of the private housing blocks is the tower, which is 100% private, and it's going to have, they're hoping for values that's substantially over £2,000 a square foot. I mean, that is not, you showed us the slide with figures for A.L. Road or figures for Gospel Road. It's in a completely different region. I mean, this is penthouses for multi-millionaires. So we think that's an inappropriate type of housing for Somerstown, which is actually a pattern book for social housing in the 20th century. And suddenly, they're putting this tower of, investment blocks in the middle. It's offensive. Yes, the viability assessment, the moment close proximity of central housing to private housing on them, they've got the negative impact of private housing values. I just think it's insensitive. At one consultation event, in fact, a cabinet officer said to a Cooper's Lane resident, you don't have to worry about light pollution, nobody's ever going to live there. And I just really question what the council is doing, building homes that nobody's ever going to live in. They want the money. I mean, that's not best value in my book. So, Sean talked a bit about ignoring planning policy. In Somerstown, Camden have ignored their own guidance on tall buildings. They said they should be sited near open space. Well, we've got them actually on the open space. I suppose that doesn't contribute in that particular policy. Heritage, you've got proper consultation. Mm. And I think it's really important that the council, when they're consulting, they say there's an option to do nothing. If the environment isn't right, if the finances aren't right to make it work, do nothing. That's something that I think is really, really important. And then we put policies so we can scrutinise their figures and challenge them. Actually, I'd like to see an environmental assessment. I think it's a system that should work. Proper consideration of environmental and health impacts. What is being flagged is sometimes going to have a huge impact on our health. There was no health impact assessment was necessary, and no environmental impact was necessary, and I think that's wrong. Homes, including private shared homes, that meet local need rather than maximising profit. It's not actually, best value, but you should be building homes that people want, not homes that make the most money. And I think that we want a council that forcefully makes the case for genuinely affordable housing. The council builds investment flats that super rich, which is what they've done, or what they're planning to do in some time. I think it makes them moral argument incredibly difficult.